Hi, I'm Dr. Tracey Marks, a psychiatrist, and I make mental health education videos. If you've ever been prescribed an antidepressant medication like fluoxetine or escitalopram for either depression or anxiety, you had to notice that it took a while to work, like weeks. This is different from medications that you take for pain, high blood pressure, or even sleep. You can see the desired effect of those medications within an hour or even sooner. Antidepressants can take anywhere from 2 to 6 weeks to see a therapeutic effect. You may notice a little improvement sooner than that, but it's usually weeks. And there's a couple of reasons for this. The first is due to the way that the drug works. Medications have to reach steady state in your body before you can get a reliable effect. When you initially take the medication, it peaks at a certain level, then it drops. You can take the medication the next day, and then you get another peak and a drop. It takes approximately 5 half-lives to reach steady state. If you have a medication that has a half-life of 24 hours, then it takes 5 days to reach steady state. So you take the antidepressant, let's say it's escitalopram, brand name Lexapro. Lexapro causes an increase in serotonin in the nerve synapse, which is a small space between the nerves. That increase doesn't fix everything. The nerve then has to react to the increase in serotonin by creating a downstream effect of changing the way the nerves behave. The nerves go through a process of downregulating and upregulating receptors to adjust to the artificially increased serotonin. These changes happen at a genetic level. Think of it as the nerve having people in the control room rewriting computer code that controls the nerve's behavior. It's a complicated process, but suffice it to say that the rewriting of code doesn't happen in an hour, but it's a domino effect. The steady state level of the serotonin knocks the first domino over, and you have to wait until you get all the way to the end to see the result. Here's what that looks like on a diagram. This is the current accepted view of the delayed effect of antidepressants. You have this increased serotonin, then a delay, then you have the downstream neuroadaptive effect, which is reducing and increasing various receptors. Then you have a change in mood that causes a change in emotional bias. What is emotional bias? A cognitive model of depression is that negative thinking both causes and perpetuates depression. But it's not just the thoughts that pop into your head, it's a negative view of the world. Depression affects what you pay attention to. You're more likely to notice facial expressions or negative facial expressions or spot negative cues in your environment and draw negative conclusions about things. This is referred to as a negative bias or negative valence. There are several psychological questionnaires that have been developed to assess a person's thoughts, and they're called scales. One such scale is the Dysfunctional Attitude Scale, developed by Arlene Weissman and Aaron Beck, who's considered the father of cognitive therapy. Dr. Beck developed the Cognitive Triad, which according to this view, are key elements behind your depression. These elements are having a negative views about the world, negative views about yourself, and negative views about the future. It's a triangle of thoughts that build on each other. So the Dysfunctional Attitude Scale is one way to measure how many of these thoughts you have and what domains they affect. The actual scale is 80 statements, and the statements address different attitude themes. For example, my value as a person depends greatly on what others think of me. This looks at your tendency to measure your self-esteem based on how other people react to you. Here's another one. If I cannot do something well, there's little point in doing it at all. This is a measure of perfectionism and rigid thinking. High scores in this subscale suggest you've set the bar so high for yourself and the world, you're doomed to feel like a failure. And this is a setup for feeling hopeless. So back to the antidepressants. Your depressed mood is closely connected to your thoughts. Antidepressants ultimately reverse negative biases, but that doesn't happen immediately. Neuroimaging studies using functional MRI have shown changes in areas of the brain like the amygdala, which affects threat perception, in the limbic region, which corresponds to memory, and frontoparietal regions, which affects attention and problem solving. What researchers have seen is antidepressants produce a more immediate effect in these regions, which corresponds to changes in your emotional regulation. So changes in your amygdala can result in less threat awareness, so you're less on edge and maybe less irritated by things. And changes in your attention and memory areas mean you focus more on positive faces and experiences. So all of this is to say, when you first start the antidepressant, the early improvements are more likely to be related to your emotions and less related to your thoughts. But your negative thinking is the big elephant in the room that continues to weigh you down and takes weeks to reverse. So here's a proposed revised diagram of how antidepressants work. And this revision is based on the neuroimaging studies showing the initial emotional response in the brain. And here's what it looks like. First, you get increased serotonin. Then after a delay, the serotonin increase directly causes the domino effect of downstream nerve receptor changes and directly changes emotional bias from negative to positive. Then there's another delay before you have improved mood due to the positive emotional changes that transform your thoughts. Now you may say, what about things like sleep and appetite and depression? How do thoughts affect that? Well, the mind is powerful. What you pay attention to and how you judge a situation determines how you experience the physical symptoms. We call this your attention and appraisal. For example, one study treated a group of depressed people with fluvoxamine. The people reported improvement in their sleep, but objective testing showed that their sleep was worse. But these people felt like they were sleeping better, even though they weren't. So thoughts and feelings and behaviors are all connected. There is a model still of what we call endogenous depression, where you develop depression solely based on brain changes. But we still believe even that depression affects your thinking. So which came first, the depression or your thoughts? That might be debatable. But the mind and the body are one. And the best approach to depression is to address them both equally. The mind approach would be through therapy or self-help measures that address your mindset. And the body approach would be diet, exercise, sleep hygiene, and medication if appropriate. Watch this video on psychological flexibility for more on how your thinking affects how you feel, including how it's connected to anxiety disorders. See you next time.